We are back, ladies and gentlemen. When it comes to dogs with itchy skin, ears, anal glands, a lot of times it's going to fall into three separate categories. Although these can be connected, they are, I would consider them three separate categories, but they can a lot of times be interrelated. And these include parasitic dermatitis, infectious dermatitis, or allergic dermatitis, or often some combination of the three, such as a flea allergy dermatitis, which would fall into the parasitic and allergic often. What I'm gonna do is go into a few concepts about itching, allergies, and towards the end of this video, I will have specific things that you as a pet owner can do at home, maybe before going to your veterinarian or with your veterinarian in order to maximize the effectiveness of their treatment plan. With anything related to allergies, all treatments, prescription or not, are all going to be about managing the symptoms, not necessarily treating the problem. If it's seasonal allergies, for example, limiting exposure to likely allergens or using anti-inflammatory medications, so when people think Claritin or Zyrtec, whereas for infectious dermatitis and parasites, we're going to be managing through treatment of the organism and be trying to encourage healing of the affected area. I do not necessarily recommend any medications for your pet. This is for educational purposes. And this is not medical advice, but some strategies that can help you help your pet. Itching is almost always caused by inflammation of the skin. The inflammation is a whole pathway, but instead of going through all of that whole pathway in depth, I'm going to summarize it for you instead in something that's easy to understand and hopefully a lot shorter than what I went through in veterinary school. The body is going to respond to proteins, and the immune system uses this to take care of and fight off invading organisms. It reacts to specific proteins on these organisms and flags them with antibodies to the immune system saying, hey, this is an invader. And sometimes this happens to relatively harmless proteins, such as the case with an allergic reaction. These often large proteins that the body creates an immune response to enter through the skin, through the air, or potentially even the GI tract. The most common, however, in dogs is actually the skin. And there's something that causes a break in that skin barrier. This can happen for many different reasons, but often dry skin is a contributing factor due to many baths, harsh soaps, really greasy skin, genetic conditions, or other things as well. This then allows allergens to absorb across the skin in places like the paw pads or the ears. The body with chronic exposure can recognize these as foreign, and thus it's going to create an immune response to stop the perceived invaders. Often this inflammation will lead to increased breakdown of the skin barrier, not less, and thus it can actually open up an area for more allergens to come across and even potentially bacterial or yeast infections, especially when there's an excessive moisture from baths, swimming, or even licking. Often, even in food allergies, the inflammation to allergens tends to occur in skin, especially in dogs. For parasites such as mange mites, fleas, ticks, and other bug bites, this usually is a local reaction specific to the area of the bite. However, sometimes a disseminated allergic reaction to a bite or sting can occur, leading to hives, vomiting, diarrhea, swelling of the face or muzzle, and even difficulty breathing. And if any of these occur, make sure that you seek veterinary care immediately, as this very strong allergic reaction, otherwise known as an anaphylactic reaction, is very, very tough on a dog's body and can actually lead to death. So veterinary care immediately is very important. So make sure you seek that out if that happens. So now we come to different control methods. These are the top five things I do not recommend doing in your dog to help control allergies or itch, and I'll go through why specifically, but these are ones that I often have seen on the internet in a lot of different places that, as a veterinarian, I just don't agree with in general. There may be some value in some of these, and I'll try to point that out when there is, but often, without veterinary consultation, these should not be done. The first one is apple cider vinegar, and although it's often recommended to use 50-50 vinegar and water, a lot of people forget the whole 50-50 part of that. And often with allergies and itching, there's often going to be open wounds on the dog's body from either scratching or from a very severe itching, and vinegar can be very painful. And sometimes you can't even see these areas without shaving the dog, or finding the areas that are affected and shaving those areas to avoid them. So I don't recommend apple cider vinegar in general. It can be very good antibacterial, but just don't unless you know for sure that the skin barrier is completely intact and there's no lesions. Number two, overbathing. I don't recommend overbathing your pet, so I would bathe your pet no more than every 2 weeks unless your veterinarian or a veterinary dermatologist tells you that, hey, you should probably do this more often, because it can really dry out the skin with and take away all the natural protective oils of the skin and really make them more prone to an allergic reaction, but also can increase the chance of them getting an infection, whether it be from yeast or bacteria. And we'll talk about it a little bit later, but a proper shampoo choice for the baths that you do have is very important not to dry out their skin and make it worse. Human bug spray. So in order to prevent your dog from itching from a bug bite, occasionally you'll hear people using DEET or other human bug products. I do not recommend this, and I very strongly will suggest not to, because DEET and many of the pesticides that we can use on our skin can be very toxic when ingested, and this especially goes for dogs. And DEET has actually been known to cause seizures, death, and a whole host of other symptoms, so just stay away from DEET-based products, and even a lot of the other human bug sprays. If you're going to use a bug spray on your dog, try to do something that is going to be low scent, like citronella, and relatively safe. Number four, generic flea collars. These are one of my pet peeves because these collars often don't work the way that they are marketed. They're approved by the EPA, which EPA has much less stringent requirements on proving effectiveness and only on a relative safety. So the EPA does not as strongly regulate these as the FDA would. And unfortunately, because of how they're regulated, they can get away with a lot more reactions and a lot lower efficacy. So make sure you're talking to your veterinarian about proper flea and tick control. This can be super important for your dog to keep them from itching, scratching, and bringing fleas into your house and even giving you fleas, which is a terrible experience. And I know that from personal experience. Number five, feeding coconut oil to your dog. This has the potential to be a good thing in proper quantities and mixed with the proper diet, but consult with your veterinarian or a veterinary nutritionist before starting to feed coconut oil to your pet, as it can cause diarrhea, weight gain, etc. But you definitely can use a high quality coconut oil in small quantities on areas that are affected by really dry or itchy skin. It can be a little bit soothing. Just make sure you don't overdo it, as that can occasionally cause an infection that would otherwise not have been there. These top six things can be very helpful in conjunction with getting a proper diagnosis from your veterinarian as to why your dog is itching. Number one, a high quality diet. And I say this because a very cheap dog food often does not have a lot of the fatty acids and a lot of the oils that can be very, very helpful for your dog's skin. So if your dog is especially itchy and you're feeding a cheap dog food, think about doing something that's like a sensitive skin and stomach diet and watch the difference in your dog's coat. It's pretty amazing. I've done this on my own dog, Watson, and it's an incredible difference in how his skin feels and how his hair feels. Number two, using an oatmeal bath during times of the year that are particularly bad, especially if your dog has seasonal allergies as diagnosed by a veterinarian. You can either do this with a homemade bath or find a recipe online for it, or you can find a high quality oatmeal shampoo, which you can find in the link in the description below, one that I personally have used and do recommend using if you're looking for an oatmeal shampoo. Oatmeal is not perfect, but it does have some anti-inflammatory properties and can really help to soothe the itch. And it's one of the more gentle shampoo types that you can use on your dog to make sure you're not stripping away all their natural oils and protection. If your dog has seasonal allergies, wiping their feet when they return from being outside can be very, very helpful. Because as we just talked about, a lot of times the allergens are crossing across the skin, and especially those areas that are becoming in highest contact with the allergens. And a lot of times this is going to be paw pads. So just wiping your pet's feet off can actually help keep their itching down because they're going to have less allergen that they're going to be exposed to. So keep this in mind the next time your pooch goes outside and comes back in itching. Number four, if your dog gets hot spots after swimming, make sure you seek veterinary care. But in the future, make sure that you are completely drying them after a bath or after they go in the lake or the pond or whatever, because a lot of times when you get that excessive moisture that stays in contact with the skin, creates such a perfect growing environment for the bacteria, specifically a staph infection, that it can be really tough to get rid of without antibiotics. Not impossible. There are definitely going to be cases that will be hard or impossible to get rid of without it. Number five, high quality flea and tick prevention. And make sure you discuss this with your veterinarian, as we're finding a lot of resistance to some of our older flea and tick medications and collars. So talk to your veterinarian about what's been working in their area, and they'll probably have some very good recommendations for your dog and their lifestyle. Number six, the other thing that can sometimes help is actually a high quality probiotic in dogs. And make sure you're finding one that's intended for animals, as it will have a slightly different bacterial composition than a human probiotic. Or you can even find some diets that have a probiotic that are integrated into them. And these can be also effective, as a healthy gut bacteria makes for a healthier dog. One that I will often recommend is Probios, as it's a relatively high quality and relatively inexpensive probiotic that's easy to come by. There are others that are better, but a lot of those are going to end up being prescription and more expensive. So talk to your veterinarian if you do have other questions about probiotics. Some veterinarians may not believe in them. I personally do believe that they are of some value. Not perfect, but again, some value. One other big point that I wanted to talk about is that with allergies, you usually will not be able to completely control the allergies in your dog, especially seasonal or food allergies. At some point, they're gonna have a flare-up, and that's expected. Just like in people, we can do the best we can to prevent exposure to allergens or mask them with different drugs, but you're never gonna prevent every single flare-up. And all of these tips are really meant to help keep your pet more comfortable longer. And maybe instead of using a prescription medication long-term, your pet can use that prescription just to control the flare, and all the things you're doing to manage it decreases the amount of time your pet has to spend on that prescription. These aren't meant to cure your pet from allergies or even prevent them from scratching, but more to help you control the itch and help you to decrease the number of flare-ups and the duration of a flare-up if they do happen, to help your pet stay healthier and more comfortable long. Thank you guys so much for watching this video. I hope you enjoyed it. If you did, make sure you like and subscribe, as it will help the video. The next video in this series is going to be talking about two specific drugs, Apoquil and Cytopoint, which are two of my favorite drugs as a veterinarian to use in my patients. Not everything, and I'm not going to recommend that you use those, but I wanted to explain how they work to you guys so that you can understand why your veterinarian may prescribe them for you. Have a fantastic rest of your day, and we'll see you in the next one.